kinds of issues are. And in terms of working out solutions, we need to sort of think a little bit about first who we need to share information with, because until we know who we need to share information with, we're not going to get the right sort of information. And there's a lot of stakeholders involved in the transfer. It's not just the doctor, the receiving surgeon, and a life call to ED, which may or may not occur. You know, there's a vast range of stakeholders who all have different information requirements when a transfer happens. The other thing to think about is how do we share information? And that principle, there's two main ways that we can share information. Traditionally, what we've done is use peer-to-peer methods, which is always at risk of a Chinese whispers outcome. Essentially, what happens is if each person is telling a story, information degrades. There's a real problem in that. The information needs of third parties isn't met when this sort of information happens. What I need to know in ED is different from what blood bank needs to know, which is different from what the theatre coordinator needs to know about an impending transfer. But in the modern world, particularly WA, we've got very good internet connectivity across the entire state hospital network. We can use shared information, and with that approach, each individual should be able to identify and focus on the pieces of information that are relevant to them. So it's a different paradigm, and they can use their own tools to access the information as well. So the stuff that we need to share from an informatics point of view, basically three kinds of things. Text is an important thing that we share. Digital media, like photographs and images, and ECGs are important. The other thing that we share increasingly in the emergency telehealth space is digital strengths, that be that either video conferencing or telephone conferencing. So in terms of text, we don't need to read this in great detail, it's just for reference later. But the information we want is concise referral information, because we could capture the narrative dialogue between referrers and the people who they're consulting about cases, that you can learn a lot about what happened in a transfer if you can capture that information. Clearly we want information handed over from the first person who learned about the transfer, handed over to those who need to know when their shift ends, so the expects information. We want to know about clinical orders that were made. We also want to know about other information about the patient, their summary health profile. You know, has the patient got an allergy that neither the referrer or the referee knows about? And is there other information, either in our own state repositories or in private information repositories, like private PAC, that we might need to know about? So in terms of the text-based information, there's where we are at the moment, West Australia, we do have an app that we use in several of our large hospitals. All the big tertiary hospitals have implemented e-referrals, and it's also can be used for cross-site referral for sites. But at the moment, it's only limited to about 10 sites, although WACS, as we speak, are in the process of a rollout. The things that we could do with e-referrals is actually develop structured questionnaires that they can be done just out of the box if we want to get specific kinds of information recorded. An interesting thing with e-referrals is that it actually supports digital media attachments. So if you have a photograph to share or a short video clip or something else, you can actually attach it to an e-referral as we speak right now. It also supports referral management, that you can actually work out who did what with a referral, whether it was accepted, whether it was rejected, whether it was handed on to someone else. And it does support a little bit of clinical narrative. You can do several responses to one referral, so you can record some information about how things change over time. But a better tool for shared clinical narrative is actually what's the state digital medical record. Although it's only implemented at Fiona Stanley at the moment, it will be rolled out to every new site that we bring online over the next few years. Although it's principally was bought as a scanned medical record, it supports e-forms and e-form-based workflows, and accounts that we use it for all our progress notes, and easily share progress notes between sites where clinicians at one site working on a patient, another clinician providing advice, that they could write up a progress note. see if you use an application that we developed as part of the education project, which is a web-based and also tablet-compatible viewing application of ICM's laboratory information and also clinical summaries and other PDFs that a patient may have, like consult or referrals or procedure reports. So I'm very pro the idea that particularly people in WACS who don't have access to ICM should be as a way of capturing and finding out some more information about their patients than they otherwise do. The only real issue with it, and I think it's dropped off from the slide here, is that if you're going to access it away from a site, let's say on your own private browser at home, you do need to have a virtual private network connection to the health network to access it, like a MIRA or an Interconnect connection. Although these are generally available for those who need them. The other thing to remember is that sometimes there's information hidden away in pathology databases where the patient normally attends, and also those who work in private will be aware that there's lots of software packages out there now that will actually integrate WA Health pathology information with information from private practice. WA Health hasn't provided a service back to us the other way. It would seem fairly logical that we use something like CVs to do that if we were going to go down that tunnel. I want to just also briefly touch when it comes to text on the role of the person controlled electronic healthcare record. The vision here is quite good. It would be really nice that for any patient coming in, we could see what their summary health profile information is, what their allergies, their common problems, their medications. It would really assist us in sort of understanding that patient when we transfer them. Unfortunately, the uptake is, at the moment has really been young people rather than the older complex people where we give value from. Of the information that's stored in there, most of it's discharge summaries, which is stuff we've already got anyway. And it's of that core of valuable information that we would want for someone who's sight and seen a shared summary, health summary, say 50,000 in the whole of Australia. So we're not quite really getting value from that yet. We need a much broader scale adoption of that. So moving on to the other forms of media, hotels, as you all know, and in terms of the three most common types of media that we share, radiology is pretty much sorted, I think. I mean, dead end site, the only way of acquiring images now, pretty much post that information up into the state PAC system for some of you. The issue for the viewer, of course, is that if they're not on site, they actually have to be into a physical machine, but it's not a so together we worked out a plan for difficult airway management, and that's for this gentleman, plans A, B and C. And he successfully intubated the patient with a bougie on the first attempt. However, after intubation, the patient's sats was still dropping. I could actually see across the video that the tube was in the right place. This guy's chest was rising symmetrically, the abdomen was not rising with ventilation, and he was very keen on pulling the tube out. And fortunately, I managed to persuade him not to, and the sats came up. And I really don't like to think what might have happened if it had been in the situation where he had pulled that tube out at that time. I think it would have been very difficult to regain control of this patient's airway. That's an extreme example. Now, in terms of the general benefits of the telehealth services, direct observation of the patient is an amazingly valuable thing in terms of being able to understand what the actual clinical state of the patient is who is being prepared to transfer. As in the case I just described, there's real value in being able to sort of talk people through procedures or directly observe them as they do procedures to ensure that they're done properly. The big benefit with the telehealth service has been the fact that you've got the same level of person providing support across the state. That emergency physicians sort of come out of a cookie cutter, but we do things generally in a very similar way. And so that's been a very useful standardisation of care when emergencies present across the state. And we've also seen some reduction and by local services, and we've also played an important role in facilitating transfer. The main benefit we have there is that most of us are familiar with the referral pathways, whereas those in the country don't really know them well. We've eyeballed the patients, so our systems tend to be fairly well trusted by those who receive them. And because we've got dedicated time, but we do tend to be more reliable in making sure all stakeholders are notified, just the one call from the person who's on the scene having to do everything. And the service now extends across the entire state. And getting quite busy. We're seeing on some days up to 100 consults a day now. And of those, perhaps 40 of them, you definitely want to use video. You probably get away with telephone for just over half of them. And a significant number of those which are being transferred. We need to decide to work out what extent we're averting transfers by using this service. Which raises a question for acute surgical service and question here that we're looking at seeking is to what extent there'll be benefit in surgeons involved in this kind of acute referral service. The main thing I would think about is that if you're going to go down that path, it has to be dedicated time and space. The first attempts at emergency telehealth, they were sort of putting in large big EDs and working as a side stream to your main work, and the model didn't work. People didn't support the machines properly, so the machines didn't always work. A clinician is busy with a patient in one cubicle, doesn't really want to drag his mind out of that, and then sort of sit in front of the screen to look at another one. And I'll be really interested in what John has to say in his speech later about his experiences from a surgical perspective in terms of its effectiveness. The last thing I just want to briefly touch on is the issue of coordination. And I'll go back to my case in Bruce Rock, where about 1.5 hours into 2 hours of real-time video care, a paramedic sort of wandered into the room. It was a complete surprise to me. I'd not requested or tasked the paramedic service chopper to come into Bruce Rock to collect this patient. As far as I was concerned, he was I don't think a great visibility of being and vice versa.